I want to talk about water and wilderness. Because as I was meditating today, suddenly it came into my mind about certain situations involving water. Another one comes to mind that I didn't think of today, and that is the turning of the water into wine at the marriage feast at Cana of Galilee. But I want to take a little glance at some situations that involved water and how three different groups, when confronted with water, each group did a different thing, but the result was more or less the same. Isn't it good to know that God has a million ways to meet needs? I am sure that if there were a million needs, God could meet that need in a million different ways. I am sure He could do that. So no matter how much our faces differ, and no matter how much our needs differ, it is good to know that God's storehouse of answers is sufficient to all of our needs. Hallelujah. My God shall supply all of your need according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus. I do not say that glibly, because God meets different needs different ways, and sometimes He meets the same needs by a whole lot of different ways. Sometimes He does it in a way that we do not anticipate. Well, more often than not, He does it in a way that we don't anticipate. Very often when we think there is no way, He shows us that it is true what His word says, He maketh a way where there is no way. And you know, people who limit their thinking in appreciating the different ways that God can move very often rob themselves of the blessing. Now, if I were to ask you to give me an illustration of that, I wonder what illustration you would give me. But I will give you one where the prophet came with the word of God, and he spoke, "Thus saith the Lord, that by this time, a certain time, the grain will be readily available and the need will be met." And someone who had no concept of how God could do it verbalized his negativity. And he said, "If there were windows in heaven, then maybe it could be." You see, he was saying, there's no way that this can be. What are you preaching about? It would take there to be windows in heaven. Well, there are windows in heaven. Because in Malachi, God said if the people would bring the tithes and the offerings and their time into the storehouse of God, then He would open the windows of heaven. So we may not see the windows, but they are there. Hallelujah. And God sometimes opens the windows of heaven to pour forth His blessing. And this man said, if there were windows in heaven. And the prophet of God said, thou shalt see it. You will behold it. But you will not partake of it. And you know what happened? When the grain came available and the siege was over, the man who had doubted, and not only doubted, but verbalized his doubt in a cynical way. You see, there's an honest reasoning, but there's also a cynical doubting. And that man was cynical in his doubting. He said, if there were windows in heaven. But when the blessing came and the windows did open and the grain came to hand and the siege was over, he was killed in the stampede of people to go for the supply that God had given. In other words, the very thing that was going to be a blessing to him or to the people became a curse to him. because of his attitude towards the promise that said it was coming. So what should have been a blessing became the catalyst for his destruction. For when the people surge to partake of that which God was giving them, he was trampled in the rush and he died. He beheld it as the prophet had said, but he did not partake of it. Keep your heart open. And when things seem impossible, remain yourself, remain the devil, and remain your fellow saints, that with God nothing shall be impossible. Hallelujah. Nothing shall be impossible. And if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. Glory to God. Amen. I tell you, there has to be miracles, because too many of us can't meet our poll tax demands, and too many of us can't meet needs that are pressing upon us. And when we don't know what way to turn, and we do our best, and we are doing our best, we find that God is merciful. And he helps us making a way often where there is no way. Praise the Lord. Beyond all belief. Amen. I talked with one good brother a while ago who didn't know how he was going to meet a certain need. And incredibly, because he wasn't paying much income tax, but incredibly, just when he needed it, he got an income tax refund that he was not expecting at all. And it was enough to meet that particular need at that particular time. God is a God who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. And when there is no way, never give up, because he maketh a way where there is no way. And I'm sure in many, many ways, your problems, you get problems the same as I get problems. And never kid yourself, well, maybe other preachers, but this preacher gets plenty of problems. And I don't live in a paradise where I wake up every morning and say, this is wonderful, no problems today. One of the first things I do is check, Dawn, what is the post? Because problems come in the post. And I have plenty of them. But you know, we're only on this earth for a little while. And I think we worry too much. And sometimes pastors and preachers go to people and say, if you go to this ministry or that ministry, who will bury you? Somebody will bury you. If it's only to get rid of the smell, they'll bury you. And we worry so much about that. And about so many other things. Don't get the idea that I'm thinking we shouldn't care anything about dying. We should remember that in the midst of life we are in death. What I'm trying to say is we get bogged down with worrying about things that we don't need to worry about. That in due time they will take care of themselves. Somebody will do that for you. They have to do that for you. If you could never get a penny out of the state or the welfare services or the I don't care whose government, Thatcher's government, Major's government or Kinnock's government or anybody else's government, that's one thing you'll get out of them, they'll bury you. So we need to get a little bit of a taste of reality and have some wisdom in our worry. What do you mean wisdom in your worry? Well, this is what I mean. I mean, don't get unduly concerned about that which worrying won't help. Ask yourself the question, will worrying about this thing help it? If it won't, then there's no point in worrying. Then look at the other side of the problem. Can I change it? If you can change it, then have the courage to set about changing it. If you can't change it, then you accept with grace that which you cannot change. You understand? What you can change, you lay hold of the courage to change. What you cannot change, you embrace with grace. But the problem is, you need to pray for wisdom to know which is which. You understand what I mean? Something you cannot change, something you can change, the grace to accept what you can't change, the courage to change what you can change, and the wisdom to know which one is which. Because if you don't have the wisdom to know which one is which, then you'd be trying to change a thing you can't change. And that's a big waste of worry. Save your worry for things that you can change, and get up and do something to change the situation. I want to talk about water and wilderness. I suppose, first of all, we should go to Exodus chapter 14. We want to look at Exodus 14, where the children of Israel were confronted with the Red Sea. We want to look at Joshua, where the children of Israel were confronted with the waters of Jordan. And we want to look at Elijah and Elisha, when they were confronted with the waters of Jordan. And all three took a different approach, but in all three we see the glory of God manifested. We read in Exodus 14, "And when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were sore afraid. And the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord, and they said unto Moses, Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt thus with us, to carry us forth out of Egypt? Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, Let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians? For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. And Moses said unto the people, Fear ye not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today." Now that was a prophecy, because Moses himself didn't know what he was going to do. "For the Egyptians whom ye have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace." Now it was a prophecy that God brought through the lips of Moses, because Moses himself did not know what he was going to do. And he did not know what the answer was. And he did not know what way to turn. They had the Egyptians behind them. They had no way out to the right hand. They had no way out to the left hand. They were squirming in their circumstances. They were sore afraid. They didn't know what they would do if Pharaoh caught up with them. Remember, they had spent some generations in the land of Egypt under the taskmaster's whip. They had been not only subdued, but they had been subjugated. They'd been underfed. They'd been underaccommodated. They'd been overworked. They had been unappreciated. And here they were again with no way out to the right, no way out to the left, and the space between Pharaoh and themselves growing narrower all the time. And without ever thinking, they cried unto the Lord. They weren't even listening for anything from heaven. And in their fear, they began to blame Moses. Then they reminded Moses that they had said certain things to him in Egypt. Then Moses prophesied what was going to happen. But he himself was crying unto the Lord. Because the word of God tells us that in verse 15, the Lord said unto Moses, "Wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward." God was rebuking him. You know, it's a problem when people behave negatively around you and they talk you out of your positive position so that you begin to cry in terror. And Moses was beginning to cry unto the Lord, "What are we going to do?" But God said, "Wherefore criest thou unto me? But lift thou up thy rod and stretch out thine hand over the sea and divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea." You know what happened. He held out the rod over the sea, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind all that night, and made the sea dry land, and the waters were divided. Amazing that the strong east wind was so accurately directed that it drove back the sea and dried up the seabed, but it never blew over the children of Israel. No way out to the right, no way out to the left, no way out behind, but God made a way where there was no way. God is never in a dilemma. Hallelujah. He has the answers. Feed the people. Lord, 300 penny worth of bread is not enough for this. Feed the people. This said Jesus to test the disciples, to try the disciples. For Jesus himself knew what he should do. But this said he to test them, to try them. And it was at that point that Andrew said, "There's a lad here with 5 loaves and 2 fishes, 1 lunch for 1 boy. But in the hands of Jesus of Nazareth, in the anointing of the Holy Spirit, it became enough to feed the multitude. He made a way where there was no way." Who are we serving anyhow? Why should we be wimps and begin to worry? What is it to worry about anyhow? The one thing you've got to do is what the writer said in the Old Testament: fear God and keep his commandments. The rest of it is not worth worrying about. But Brother Chambers, have you had a mortgage to pay? I have. But Brother Chambers, have you had this or that? Well, I have plenty of this and that. And I have no wage that I can depend on, knowing that it is coming in week by week or month by month, that I'll get so much. So maybe if you look at my worries, they're as big as your worries and maybe a bit bigger. But God maketh a way where there is no way. He is never stuck for an answer. In the wilderness where they could see no rivers, where they could find no lakes, where they had no apparent artesian wells, God told Moses to speak to the rock, and the rock gave forth water to feed the multitude. He made a way where there was no way. They were on the move. They didn't have time to plant the gardens and grow the mushrooms. But God made a way where there was no way. He gave them manna in the morning. Morning manna. Hallelujah. Marvelous, marvelous God. So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea,
The Lord caused the wind to blow. The waters were divided. The children of Israel went through the midst of the sea on dry ground. And the waters were a wall unto them on their right hand and on their left. Now listen, I want you to see how that what seemed to be the obstacle and what looked like an enemy became a friend. For when the children of Israel crossed over, Pharaoh got proud in his heart and he thought he would do the same. So he and his chariots and his horsemen got into the midst of the sea. But God looked upon them in the midst of the sea and spoke to Moses, and Moses stretched out the rod over the sea, and the waters that had been divided came together again. You see, what was an obstacle to them, God turned it into a pathway to paradise, and it became a destruction for the enemy. Think it not strange concerning the fiery darts of the enemy and the trial of your faith. When he hath tested you, you'll come forth as gold, because he that hath begun a good work in you is able also to perfect that which concerneth you. He has started it and he'll finish it. Amen. Praise the Lord. Then look at Joshua. And Joshua is at the River Jordan. And they want to get across, and it's a difficult time of the year. You know, they tell us these are difficult times. The economy is crumbling. I know it's difficult to get jobs, but sometimes the not getting of a job is an answer. I guess what I am saying is, in Joshua chapter 3, where we discover the children of Israel crossing over Jordan, it was a bad time to cross Jordan. The Word of God says that Jordan overfloweth all his banks all the time of harvest. Verse 15 of Joshua 3. It was a bad time to cross over. It was a bad time to step out. But when the priests that bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord stood firm on dry ground in the midst of Jordan, that was the result of the priests that bear the ark of the Lord getting their feet wet in the first place. For the Word of God says that when the feet of the priests that bear the ark were come unto Jordan, and the feet of the priests that bear the ark were dipped in the brim of the water, for Jordan overfloweth all his banks all the time of harvest, the waters were cut off and rose and stood upon an heap, so that the children of Israel went forth across Jordan dry shod. He made a way where there was no way. You know, when you look at modern maps explaining the march of the children of Israel and explanations, you know, They show you that the children of Israel crossed Jordan at a place where it wasn't deep. But the Bible says the feet of the priests were dipped in the brim of Jordan, and the Jordan was overflowing all his banks. They try to tell us that in the crossing of the Red Sea, they selected a special little place where they could just kind of step across, no problem. That's interesting. Very interesting. Because Pharaoh and his army drowned in a few feet of water then. When will men learn that the God who framed the world by the word of his power is the God who is reigning supreme today, and he still works all things after the counsel of his own will. Hallelujah. He is God, and besides him there is none other. There's no one that God can sit down to talk with and look on him as an equal, for he has no equal. He is the supreme being, the creator of the universe, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He is the one besides whom there is none other. Hallelujah. So there you have the children of Israel crossing the River Jordan in a way where there was no way. Then if you go to the book of Kings, in chapter 2 of 2 Kings, you find Elijah and Elisha at the River Jordan. And it came to pass, verse 9, when they were gone over, that Elijah said unto Elisha, ask what I shall do for thee before I be taken away from thee. And Elisha said, I pray thee, let a double portion of thy spirit be upon me. Now, that was the place of promise that he had come to. But in order to get there, he had to go to the brink of Jordan with Elijah. And in verse 8, when Elijah took his mantle and wrapped it together and smote the waters, they were divided hither and thither, so that they too went over on dry ground. He made a way where there was no way. They didn't make a boat. They didn't get an aircraft. They didn't call a helicopter. They didn't get on a barge. He smote the waters with his mantle, and a way was made where there was no way. What am I saying? I am saying that when Moses stretched out the rod, that rod represented the power of God with them. When the priest stood in the water at the brink of Jordan under Joshua, they didn't just stand with their hands by their side. They were holding the Ark of the Covenant, which represented the presence and the power of God with them. When Elijah smote the waters of Jordan with his mantle, the mantle represented the power and the presence of God with him. Remember, Elisha picked up the same mantle and smote the same waters and had the same results. Amen. What did you see at Jordan with Elijah and Elisha? You saw, number one, an ascending master. Elijah was taken up. Number two, you saw a watching disciple. Elijah was taken up. Elisha was looking up. You've got that. You had an ascending master. You had a watching, a waiting disciple. And the mantle came down. You had a descending power. Did not Jesus, the ascending master, say to the watching disciples, ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be my witnesses? You see, the significant thing at the Red Sea, at the River Jordan with Joshua, at Jordan with Elijah, was the thing that they had in their hands that represented the power and the presence of God with them. Moses had a rod. Joshua had the Ark of the Covenant. Elijah had a mantle, but all three things represented the one power, the power of the supreme God of the universe. Glory to God. Now, you may not think you have a rod, but you have. That rod, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me still. You have a rod. You have the Ark of the Covenant, because that Ark represented Christ, we are told in the New Testament, and you have the presence of Christ with you. You have a mantle. You have a mantle, for we have been clothed with the Holy Ghost. Ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. You have the rod, you have the ark, you have the mantle, and you have everything else necessary to the task. Why am I saying that? Because when Jesus Christ went into the wilderness in Luke chapter 4, and the devil tempted him after Jesus had fasted for 40 days and was afterward unhungered, and the enemy came and tempted him in the physical realm and the point of his need, saying, if you be the Son of God, command these stones that they be made bread. But Jesus showed what he had, for he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. So the devil who tested him in the physical realm failed to overcome him in that realm. Why? Because Jesus depended on the authority of the Word of God. When your circumstances are bad, when your problems are pressing, it is not enough to say, bad old devil, I don't want you around, please go from me. It is written that man shall not live by bread alone. And the devil, taking him up into an high mountain, showed unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, all this power will I give thee, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me, unto whomsoever I will give it. If thou therefore wilt worship me, all shall be thine. So he tempted him in the realm of the spirit, in the realm of worship. Worship me, take a shortcut to the kingdom, and all shall be thine. Jesus said, get thee behind me, Satan. Not just, I don't want to have anything to do with you, devil. For it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. So in the spiritual realm there, in the realm of worship, Christ overcame the enemy. And then he brought him to Jerusalem and set him on a pinnacle of the temple and said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down from hence, for it is written, oh, the devil tries the booker. He shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee. More Christians fail right there with a misinterpretation of the scripture, with a wresting and a twisting of the word of God, with taking the text out of its context and applying it wrongly, and they get in a real dilemma, in a real twist, and in a wilderness of loss. So the devil came with the word, but Jesus twisted the word back to the position it should be in. The devil twisted it away, but Jesus turned it back again. For it is written, he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against the stone. And Jesus answering said unto him, it is said or written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. And when the devil had ended the temptation, all the temptation, he departed from him for a season. He didn't go away to stay away. He went away to gather his forces and have another go later. But I am sure, and you know for reality, that when he came back later, he found that Christ still had the same answers. He had the word of God hidden in his heart, and that gave him the mastery over the enemy. I say again, we have a rod of authority and comfort. I say again, we have the ark of the presence of the Lord. I say again, we have the mantle of God's power. And whether we're in a paradise or a wilderness, we know that he is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the throne with exceeding great joy. We know that greater is he that is in us than he that is within the world. We know that in the cold he is with us with a fiery cloudy pillar. We know that in the heat he is with us with a cloud to overshadow us. We know that these things were written for our admonition and for our learning, because God wants us to know from now until eternity that even if there are a million needs, He has a million ways to meet the need. But it is the one power, the one God, the one person who has the answer. Hallelujah. And you can depend on it. And I'm not saying it's easy, but you can depend on it, for up there you'll see the need met. How? I don't know how most of the time, but I know He is faithful that promised. I know He is totally good. I know He is not unrighteous to forget our labor of love. I know that He watches over His word to perform it, and He hastens to bring it to pass. I know that we are precious in His sight. I know that not one sparrow falls to the ground, but that He knows about it, and that of how much more value are you than many sparrows. I know that man doesn't clothe the flower of the field. Consider the lilies, how they grow. They don't toil about it. But Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. I know Him that has said, "Fear not, little flock. It is the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." I know Him that had said, "Yes, sure enough, in the world you shall have tribulation, but be not afraid, for I have overcome the world." I know Him that hath said, "He hath not given us the spirit of fear to fear again, but the spirit of love and of power and of a sound mind." I don't know what is going to happen tomorrow, but I know who holds tomorrow. I try to hold Him. But more than hold Him, I want Him to hold me.